Hello and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Steve Sharp. I'm a school counselor and K-12 school counseling coordinator and a passionate advocate for computer science and STEM education. I want to take a minute and just acknowledge that today is National Technology Day. In addition, it's Teacher Appreciation Week. So please, thank you to all the educators who are joining us today. It's my pleasure to bring you the season finale, our last webinar in the Advising webinar series hosted by NCWIT's Counselors for Computing. Each month, we connected you through with thought leaders on the cutting edge of technology. This series offers a unique opportunity to dive into the intersection of computer science with the traditional and non-traditional STEM fields, and also known as CS plus X. Through the presentation, we would love for you to submit your questions through the Q&A in the chat, featured on the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. We will also be sharing resources in the chat featured also found at the bottom of your screen. So before we get started, the National Center for Women in Information Technology, or NCWIT, is a nonprofit organization of more than 1,500 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with the resources to take action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. Before NCWIT, programs focusing on women computing existed mostly in isolation, without the benefit of the shared best practices, effective resources, communication with others, or the national reach. Today, these programs are part of NCWIT community, creating a far greater impact than if institutions acted alone. Counselors for Computing is one of the programs in the NCWIT K-12 Alliance. The NCWIT Counselors for Computing program provides information and resources that help school counselors join in the front line of computing conversations. We bring people and programs together with the professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students, and I say that again, all students, access to transformative computing careers. I'd like to take a minute, and to be clear, we wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM, and the largest employer of scientists and engineers in our nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships, scholarships for students, and many career development opportunities for educators. We shared their website in the chat for you to learn more. I'd like to now introduce our speakers for today. First, I'd like to introduce you to Jennifer Iriti, Assistant Vice Chancellor for Research, Inclusion, Outreach Strategy, and a research scientist at the Learning and Research Development Center at the University of Pittsburgh. I'd also like to introduce Mackenzie Ball, STEM Push Hub and Director of Outreach and Alumni Engagement in Pitt School of Computing and Information. Also, Dr. Becky Gonda is a Teaching Associate Professor and Director of Outreach for the Department of Biological Sciences at the University of Pittsburgh. And last, and certainly not least, Janine Langford is the director of CSU East Bay MESA program. Thank you all so much for joining us today. At this point, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Iriti.
Great, thank you so much, Stephen. We really appreciate it. And I'm so delighted to be here. We're excited to tell you about the STEM Push Network, which is a National Science Foundation funded alliance. And we bring together pre-college STEM programs. So I'll invite my colleague, Mackenzie, to get us started and tell you how STEM Push came to be and what we've been up to.
Thanks. So this work grew out of our own experiences as directors of pre-college STEM programs who witnessed inequity in college admissions processes firsthand. And thus we created the STEM Push Network. PUSH stands for Pathways for Underrepresented Students to Higher Ed. See, we know that certain racial and ethnic groups are critically underrepresented in STEM fields, in particular Black, Latine, and Indigenous students. Valuing individuals from these racial groups and increasing access to STEM brings new ideas to bear in solving society's problems and offers fulfilling and lucrative career opportunities for these young people. Yet there are entrenched gaps in the pre-K to 20 education systems that prevent minoritized students from being admitted to and graduating from STEM fields. Many universities and community-based organizations have responded to disparities in both access and support by offering pre-college programs that increase student interest, preparation for, and success in undergraduate STEM programs. Pre-college STEM programs enable students to participate in enrichment and research experiences that impart analytical and critical thinking skills and habits of mind that are predictive of success in STEM. However, participating minoritized students, even when demonstrating significant learning gains and mastery and engaging in work that changes understandings of scientific problems, may not be accepted for admission into the same institutions due to policies that filter out applicants based on standardized test scores and other racially biased admissions metrics. As a result, while many pre-college programs successfully recruit and prepare underrepresented students for STEM fields, these programs have not been leveraged to increase the number of minoritized students admitted to undergraduate STEM programs. And so the diversity and success we see in our pre-college STEM programs is not matched in our undergraduate STEM programs. STEM Push is creating the first nationwide network of pre-college STEM programs accredited for meeting quality standards for broadening participation. Our vision is based on the following. If pre-college STEM programs utilize research-based practices for broadening participation and can communicate their value to admissions, then more underrepresented students will gain admission and persist in STEM. The way that we are going to do this is with our partners, we will build both a powerful collaborative improvement space using the Network Improvement Community Model, or NIC, and a next generation accreditation model that will serve as a mechanism for communicating the power of pre-college programs to admissions offices. This is a map that reflects the programs that we are currently working with in our NIC. We now have 43 pre-college STEM programs from across the country working together in our NIC to improve along our quality standards. Some of these are located in regions together and connected to STEM ecosystems, like we have Remake Learning here in Pittsburgh. We do not work with students directly. Rather, we work with these pre-college STEM programs. Our educational program, or NIC, is focused on strengthening these programs in their ability to recruit and prepare underrepresented students for STEM undergraduate programs. So the pre-college STEM programs work with the students, and we work with the pre-college STEM programs. These are established, urban-based, STEM-focused, out-of-school time programs committed to equity that work with high school students with a significant due component to the programming. The pre-college programs must be rigorous out-of-school time programs with STEM-centric curricula, serve high school students in urban areas, have the goal of improving STEM college-going outcomes for Black, Latine, and Indigenous students, have in-depth engagement, and the program leadership has agency to make changes to strengthen the program along STEM push quality standards. And now I'll turn it over to my colleague, Jen Iriti.
Super. So as Mackenzie mentioned, the STEM Push Network is built around a networked improvement community model. I'll say more about what that is in just a minute, but the visual on the left lets you kind of see the overall structure. We have a networked improvement community of 43 pre-college programs that work together as like a learning engine. That's the space where they're really trying to improve how they serve Black, Latine, and Indigenous students. And they focus their work around these quality standards that are tied to being able to broaden participation and effectively serve Black, Latine, and Indigenous students. Those same quality standards are also at the heart of the next generation accreditation process that we're building with the Middle States Association. And so you can see that interlocking ring of the learning engine with the networked improvement community, the core standards that hold what we know from the research about what matters for being able to broaden participation, and then this accreditation system that what we're hoping and hypothesizing will help admissions offices be able to give credence and value to students' pre-college STEM program experiences. So I promised I'd say a little more about a networked improvement community, a NIC. A networked improvement community, it integrates two big ideas: the tools and technologies of improvement science joined with the power of networks. And the way this works is we focus in on some core drivers that we think if we make movement or progress on, it will really change the outcomes that we're seeking for the students that we're trying to work with. And so for STEM Push, the drivers that we've focused on are our programs being able to recruit more and different students, nurturing STEM identity and sense of belonging, developing competencies that matter for the practice of STEM, and strengthening the college-going pathways from these pre-college programs. So all of our programs focus on working in these areas. We use the improvement science methodology that I mentioned to first, we spend time trying to understand that problem of why Black, Latinx, and Indigenous students are not being accepted into and persisting in post-secondary at similar rates to other students. Then we focus our efforts together on a shared aim. And then we generate ideas of how might we move the needle on some of these things. And then our programs test these using a plan, do, study, act model. And as they build evidence of what works and what doesn't, those things that work are spread and scaled. So it functionally looks like this. All of the programs are doing these plan, do, study, act cycles aligned with those core drivers that you see here. The result after many rounds of testing is some of those ideas fall by the wayside and they're abandoned. Others are adopted and they're tested again and tested in different contexts. And the result can become these change packages, these improvement packages that you see here. We've got two that are pushed out. And these are multi-page documents that lay out what you can do to extend recruitment and broaden your recruitment and the specific methods and practices that have been found to be effective within STEM Push are shared in those change packages, which they'll be adding links in there for you to see if you'd like. So what does STEM Push look like? We have recruited and onboarded 45 programs. We have 43 currently in the network. We are collectively across the programs, about 8,000 students are served each year through these programs. And we've been able to retain about 83% of the programs year over year. We're currently in our halfway through our fourth year. And we have about 82% attendance at our network events, which is pretty great considering these pre-college programs are typically, you know, sometimes they're a one person show. They have small staffs and lots of turnover. So we just were together for our in-person convening in March. So this is a bunch of our network leaders, and we had a wonderful time together. And they're from all over the country, as you saw on our map. And then the last thing I'll share with you is just what we're doing next is we're trying to bridge pre-college STEM programs and admissions. And as we mentioned, we're doing this in a few ways. One, developing a common language. For example, we've built out a profile that pre-college programs can do. It's a two-page, high-impact sort of information sheet about the program that is made available to admissions officers and can be linked in the Common app. Trying to build with admissions how we talk about valued outcomes and competencies that matter. Building new pathways between pre-college programs and admissions. This includes sort of the accreditation that we're trying to build, but other ways too with direct relationships between pre-college programs and higher ed. And then we're pressing on admissions to think about and consider other information and metrics on students that haven't been traditionally the key drivers. And so we're working on ways for pre-college programs to share more of their outcomes data on students with admissions. And lastly, we're also collecting data from all of our pre-college programs, their past students, so their alum and their current students. We're gathering their National Student Clearinghouse data on the students' college-going patterns. So it's the first ever study to see the impact across pre-college programs. And we're hoping it'll be really powerful data demonstrating the efficacy and the power of these pre-college programs. So what we'd like to do is spend a few minutes letting you hear directly from some of the program leaders who work directly with students and who also do outreach with high schools to recruit students and engage with counselors and STEM teachers. And you can hear a little bit from them about their engagement with the network and how it has shaped their practice. So let me invite Becky Gonda to come and share some of her experiences.
Thanks, Jen. Really happy to be here with you all this evening or afternoon, depending on where you're located. And just tell you kind of about the program that I run at the University of Pittsburgh within the biology department, and how we've taken what we've learned from the NIC and applied it to our program to hopefully reach more students and get them into college. And so Gene Team's mission really is centered around biological sciences and specifically doing research in biology. But what we really want to focus on, not only the research, giving students that experience, but also preparing them for college. So we spend time in that college prep. And really what we want to do is, as Jen and Mackenzie have been talking about, is increase participation by historically underrepresented students in STEM. We hope that immersing them in that research and giving them the college prep is a way to do that. So go ahead to the next slide. Thank you. So to tell you a little bit about the program, this is, like I said, it's out of the biology department at Pitt. We offer it exclusively to students from urban school districts in our area, mainly Pittsburgh Public Schools, which is the main district in the city, but we do extend out a little bit beyond there. Like I said, we work on a research project from a lab at Pitt, and the goal is to advance the research. We have them for 4 weeks, and we admit 18 to 20 students, and we work as a team. We live up to the name Gene Team, working as a team to advance that research. And so during that 4 weeks, you know, we're working on something that is unlike anything they've done in school. So we spend, you know, a lot of time on the front end, just building on what they might have learned in their biology class, and really, you know, digging in deep with the science and connecting it with the biology basics. Most of our students are just out of ninth grade. Because I'll tell you in a little bit how we traditionally recruit our students is through working with the biology teachers. Part of our outreach program during the academic year supplies curriculum to teachers. And so we have a partnership with Pittsburgh Public Schools, which has served us really well. We get to know the teachers throughout the school district. And so we utilize the teachers to advertise. And so most of our students are just out of ninth grade, having just taken that intro bio course. Like I mentioned, along with the research, want to focus on some of that pathway to college. So even though most of our students are just out of ninth grade, we feel like it's a good opportunity to do some of that preparation early. So we teamed with Pittsburgh Public Schools, our academic resource center at Pitt, and the Office of Admission Financial Aid to kind of build a basically program that we can do over lunch with them to start building those skills, how to look into college, how to find supportive institutions, how to look for financial aid, exploring majors, those types of things. And then finally, one thing that we noticed a lot is that once our students are with us for the summer, they still have the rest of their high school ahead of them, and they like to come back. and so we formed what's called the Gene Team Science Corps as a way to continue working with our students and build them as science communicators so that they can share and be science ambassadors to their peers and younger students in the school district and in the community and kind of like across the city. So the students, you know, some of the tangible benefits that we provide for them, we do provide a stipend for the time that they're with us. And we also provide bus passes so that, you know, that's not a barrier for them. We give them that opportunity to work on current cutting edge research, which, you know, how many high school students are able to say that they've done that? And one of the things that I like most about the program is the project changes summer to summer, depending on which lab we're partnering with. And we're able to see students latch on to the project itself, but then also build skills beyond just that project. So we want to, you know, make sure that they understand the biology and the specific experiments that they're working on. But what we find by the end of the program is that, you know, their critical thinking skills are way improved. The way that they can design experiments, problem solving, all of those transferable skills, doesn't really matter which project we're working on, we're able to build over the course of those 4 weeks. Like I said, we work on the college prep, and they have the opportunity at the end of the program to present their data again as a team to the university scientists. And that's pretty much my favorite day of the entire year, not just this program, but the entire year, because they give a scientific presentation and are able to answer the scientists' questions in a way that it's at least at an undergrad level, if not higher. And, you know, for seeing where they come in, just having ninth grade biology, most of them, to get to that point after 4 weeks, it's really, really rewarding for us, but also for the students as well. And just to point out some of their accomplishments, really great accomplishments, every summer we meet our goal of advancing the research. And so we always have data and products to return to the research labs. And we do assessment every summer, and we assess their content knowledge. Again, being immersed in the research, there's really never a question of whether that improves. You know, they come in having no knowledge of the research, and then again at the end are able to very effectively communicate what they learned. Like I said, we assess their critical thinking skills and also their sense of belonging in STEM. And we see great increases in that sense of belonging as well. And then, like I said, the Gene Team Science Corps has been really a great thing to watch them become advocates for science within the school district, because the younger students and their peers will get excited about STEM a lot more from them than they might from me. So one of the things that we wanted to work on within STEM Push was recruitment. So despite, you know, offering our program exclusively to the urban school districts and particularly Pittsburgh Public Schools, what we found was Pittsburgh Public has 10 high schools. We were traditionally getting applications from 3 mainly of those high schools. So we knew we were missing students. So even though we worked with these teachers from across the entire district, we really weren't utilizing that in a way, or the teachers weren't necessarily identifying students who might be interested in our program through no fault of their own. And, you know, we had to think about other ways to get the word out. And we wanted to, you know, think about other areas outside of the schools where students will be. And so Pitt opened up these community engagement centers, what they call the front door to Pitt, within neighborhoods in within the city. And right now there are two open, one in Homewood and one in the Hill District, which are two areas with very high numbers of traditionally underserved students. And so they have a lot of great programming already happening in those centers. So we wanted to partner with them to not reinvent the wheel and to just kind of see if we could get our foot in the door and get to meet students who we wouldn't have otherwise. So we developed an after-school program that we wanted to run in the centers. It was a six-week program, once a week after school. Students that they were already engaged with signed up. And we spend the time building on content, building on stuff that they're learning in school, and introducing them to experiments that they are common in biology research. So again, doesn't really matter what the research project is over the summer. The experiments that we do with DNA extraction or gel electrophoresis, those are common techniques that they would see again. So we're hoping through that we build their skills, also their confidence, and really build the relationship with the students was the biggest outcome from that. And through that, and through these centers, we were able to participate in community dinners. And so again, something the center was already hosting that had families in was not solely focused on gene team, but we were able to come and offer a short experience with them. We did a DNA extraction from strawberries with the whole families, and that was a big hit. So what I was hoping was that, you know, also engaging with the families would help encourage students to, you know, get that hook. And so in addition to all of that, you can see on the screen here is a flyer that we created that, you know, could just be housed at the Community Engagement Center. On the back of that flyer is FAQs about the program. So, you know, they can, if it was something that they were interested in during that community dinner, take that flyer home with them. And, or if they were visiting the engagement center, you know, maybe that would catch their eye. So those were things that we were testing. With the NIC work, and our first go at it, we saw number of applicants increase 13% from these neighborhoods. So we were very, very happy with that. and so continuing it on, last year was our first year, again this year, and we'll be continuing to track that to make sure it's effective. And again, just trying to find students we know we were missing before. And along with the recruitment, we just want to make sure that our selection process is as equitable as possible as well. So we have the online application that there is a QR code and link to, but we also provided paper applications. The community engagement centers have computer labs as well. So while we were there, students could pop into the computer lab to do the online application. So we just, again, wanted to make sure they had access in any way possible. Within the application, one thing that I decided a while ago to do is just not ask for long essays. And really, it takes a little bit more time, but interview each student that applies. So really every student that applies, we're not narrowing down based on the application that they provide. We don't necessarily look at their grades when we're making selections because grades are variable from school to school. And so with the interview, what we do, and I don't even like using the term interview with the students, it's a conversation. I give them a prompt ahead of time that has to do with the project that we're working on. And it's a way for me to see how they think through the problem. And I tell them they can prepare in any way possible, but it's not something they can look up in their textbooks. So they really do have to kind of think through it on their own, how they would approach it, kind of looking at, you know, what sort of questions are they asking? How are they thinking through the project itself? And I really emphasize with them that there is no right answer. Just like in science, it's making hypotheses. How would you test it? What predictions would you make? And we just talk about it then when I meet with the students. And so, of course, some of them are nervous and some students might be a little bit more introverted, but you know, so I'll ask them some probing questions to just kind of see how they're thinking about it. And it really helps me see who is dedicated and wants to put in the, you know, the effort to have that conversation with me. Even if they're a little bit nervous, you know, that's okay. I can tell who's nervous, but still interested versus whose parent made them sign up, kind of. And that really helps also when we're working as a team, help me put them in groups to make really well-rounded groups so that we have diversity of thought and, you know, different personalities in the group that can make sure that we have, again, just a well-rounded group that can help move everything forward. And so far, that has worked really well for us. And just to round things out, this is my contact information. I'm really happy to talk with you more, answer questions that you have at the end. And thank you for your time, and we'll turn it over to Janine.
All right, thank you so much. So happy National Technology Day. I did not know that was today. So yes, we did it. I'm very excited. Thank you so much for inviting us to be here today. So my name is Janine Langford. You can see my stuff up there. I'm representing California State University East Bay's MESA program. And I'm just gonna walk through really what STEM Push Network, how it's impacted our MESA Center. So just some really, really brief history. MESA started in 1970 out of UC Berkeley. Go Bears. And the engineering faculty, they piloted a new program to reach out to communities who had really been historically excluded in engineering, right? And so they dubbed the program MESA because we all love acronyms, and that stands for Math, Engineering, and Science Achievement. And then by 1977, that program actually moved from UC Berkeley into the University of California Office of the President and expanded out across the state. We actually didn't get it to CSU East Bay until 2007, but that's another story for another day. By 1982, MESA actually expanded to a national program. It started in California, that's right, and then Washington State, Colorado, New Mexico. And today, I believe we're in 10 states, but we're being recorded. So if I'm wrong, I'm sure one of my colleagues will let me know if that's wrong if they watch this. All right. So to date, we have 18 centers across California. That number is absolutely correct. And the majority of these centers are housed at college campuses, so including CSU East Bay. Our center serves about 19 schools throughout the year with about 600 students, middle and high school students, and we work with 28 credentialed teachers. So we're working really closely with the schools, in the schools, working with administrators. And again, our teachers are really at the core of what we're doing, and we work in an after-school setting. So every center operates a little bit differently to address the unique needs of the students we serve, but at the base, we're grounded in a few things. So one is engineering design principles, including computer science and computer engineering. Two is that we have projects that give students the skills to develop, prototype, and iterate. And three, we have annual competitions where students get to showcase their work. Our center, we focus on a few distinct areas of work as well. So a few highlights are that we run a leadership program for our middle and high school students. Two, we prioritize professional development for our teachers. And finally, we make clear connections to college and career by bringing in college students, faculty, industry partners, all of those folks into our programming. Okay, so it was just like a really brief, like high level look at MESA. I know I went fast. We got a lot of information out there if you need it. But really what I wanna be able to do now is take a moment to share a couple of stories from our center. So these students right here, they were in eighth grade when this picture was taken. This is a group who came out of Antioch, which is kind of a small community really sort of tucked away in the East Bay. You have to drive like an hour and a half. They're very isolated out there just to get out to them. And these students are part of a National Engineering Design Competition, also known as NEDC. It is the only competition in Mesa that actually goes on to a national level. And so what students are required to do is they have to prototype a human-centered design project that focuses on equity. So Iriti, this lovely lady second to the left here, she was in seventh grade when she joined Mesa. And the only reason she joined Mesa is her friend Bethany standing next to her, second from the right. And Iriti did not see herself as a STEM person, but Bethany went into this after-school program. Iriti tagged along and was like, I guess I'll do this because my buddy is here. And then they ended up working on a project together. Their first year was a project called Blue Box. It was really cool. It was about students who had ADHD, getting them focused up. And they did really, really well. But they kind of got the bug of like, we need to get first place. So they came back this year and they formed Team ThermAlert. And Team ThermAlert was based on, they had to use an Arduino. So they designed an Arduino. And what they did was, Uretzi's dad is a construction worker. And he had had heat stroke, which if you know how serious heat stroke can be, it can actually be fatal. And so they decided they wanted to create a prototype that could detect heat stroke. And it could send an alert to the person who is potentially experiencing overheating, potentially their boss, and to loved ones. So it could kind of alert them like, hey, you're starting to overheat. You need to cool down, all right? In addition to that, Natalia, who's over here on our far right, she has family members who are field workers. And so another very high risk group for heat stroke. And so these eighth graders, again, eighth graders, we're talking 12 and 13 years old, put together this project and this prototype to basically address these issues. And in their project, they talked about inequities in healthcare, in immigration status, and just access. I mean, it was inspiring. It was inspiring. They ended up representing all of California at the middle school level. And they ended up going to nationals. They represented all of us and they got third place. Now, they weren't super happy with third place. I'm so thrilled they got third place. But this year they came back as freshmen and they beat out all of the seniors. They didn't make it onto our state, but they beat out all of the seniors. And then they're like, we didn't win. I'm like, you're freshmen. This is incredible. So just know, look at these faces. They're taking over the world. But here's the question we have now. So we've got the Iritzis, we've got the Bethanys, and they both are talking so much about, now they come back to our program every year. They're talking to the students about how wonderful it is. But we need to figure out how we get more Iritzis and we get more Bethanys. Bethany, by the way, now she defines herself as a coder. Like this is how she like, I'm a coder. I'm like, yeah, you are. So we really want to do this, but how do we scale this work? How do we do it? All right, so STEM Push, this is where it comes in. The STEM Push Network is giving us a chance to really scale and hold a space for our pre-college STEM programs. Professionals in these programs, we get to experiment so we can learn and grow. We get to fail forward, which we tell our students to do. We actually get to do that work now as pre-college STEM programs as part of this network. So it's a really unique network of peers that we get to work in improvement communities and we focus on pieces of work and then bring ideas back to the collective. So I'm going to talk about some of the improvement groups I've been fortunate to be in. And some of you might be thinking, well, yeah, of course, this is a good practice. You should have been doing it all along and you would be right. But here's the thing. If you know pre-college STEM programs, we don't often have the staff or the resources, either time or financial, to experiment and add additional layers of programming. I was a team of one for like 3 years. We just hired people. So it was just me being like, I hope I'm doing the best I can do here, along with supporting the teachers. Did not really have the time to build things and fail and experiment, right? So really what happens is being part of STEM Push, it cuts down on the amount of time we need to invest to make positive changes in our programs and gives us the opportunity to benefit from the incredible minds of people developing and running their own programs across the country, like what Becky is doing, what Mackenzie is doing. It's amazing. And then we get guidance from the STEM Push Hub. So Jen is just, she's amazing. Amazing human being. It's also low risk to try something. And, you know, we can choose to either adapt or abandon these different routines that are developed out of our improvement groups. And some, you know, for those who choose to adapt, they'll try new things. And then we get to this amazing archive of like, wow, all of these different ways we can adapt these different routines to fit into our programs. So it's really incredible. All right, so I'm going to highlight four areas of what it's looked like for CSU East Bay Mesa. I'm going to focus on identity and belonging for our students, working on an alumni improvement group, improving recruitment strategies, which is very important, and better integration of college and career activities. All right, so when it comes to surveys, finding the kinds of questions that we should ask that'll help us assess the impact of our program has been a challenge. For those of you who have done surveys, you know there's a lot of options out there. There's a lot of ways we can ask about STEM identity and belonging. And so I was fortunate, the very first improvement group I was in worked on paring down a vetted sampling of approximately a dozen surveys, along with the development and research behind those surveys. And it just gave us the ability to pick and choose what made the most sense for our program. And it helped us to better understand our students and where our program could provide support, where our gaps were and where we could actually improve. Okay, really brief on that one. Another improvement group I served on was about building alumni networks in our programs. And I had a specific role in that, which was to gather a group of current high school students to ask them what they thought about alumni. You know, what should an alumni group do? How should we be supporting you? It turns out they don't know much about what an alumni group is, but we did learn some things that fundamentally changed our program. The first was that students wanted to find ways to give back. They emphasized the importance of community and keeping that connection going beyond their time in Mesa. That was very important to them. Secondly, they want fun ways to connect and engage with each other. Not surprising, they want to have fun. And finally, they wanted more opportunities to give feedback and think about program development. And I'm going to tell you, this one kind of surprised me. We finished our focus groups and they were like, so we're doing more of these, right? We want to tell you more about what we think. And I was like, oh, I guess we are. So this led to some very specific programmatic changes for us. And the big example is we actually developed a leadership program out of this work where we could get leaders from each chapter or school to come in and participate in a monthly virtual session where they could learn about the center and programming and be more connected to the work we're doing, where they could provide feedback, they could brainstorm programming ideas, they could develop leadership skills, and most importantly, they could have fun. Really brief aside, we had a student who loved Gartic Phone. If you know Gartic Phone, I now love it too, but she kept saying, we have to play. And finally I was like, you know what, fine. You want to run it, run it. And it turned out it was so much fun that the students at the end of every session would demand we play Gartic Phone. And it was just a good way to connect and have a good time. And it was awesome. And it worked. The students looked forward to it. I had students being like, I hate Zoom meetings. I'm so excited to come to these every single month. They were awesome. All right. The third area of work I want to highlight, a recruitment improvement group, and maybe the most foundational one for us. So recruiting historically excluded populations in STEM to out-of-school and after-school programs is crucial, but it's not always easy to do because students like Iriti will self-select out. They'll just say, I don't have a strong STEM identity. I don't find the space to be a welcoming community. And so in years past, our program was really recruiting through the teachers, which is great. It's a good model to use because Mesa has that opportunity, but they're still missing students who aren't in their sphere of influence. So as we thought about this work, we brought it back to the student voice and really focused on peer-to-peer recruitment. And so at the core of this was guiding students through activities that help them shape a story about who they are, what's important to them, the role that Mesa had in their lives, the space to reflect on Mesa at their schools, and then really the encouragement to envision a future of Mesa. So we walked them through a couple of exercises. One was a leadership shield or a coat of arms you can see on the screen there. They worked on small teams to talk about their skills. What have they developed? What are their leadership skills? What are their values, their accomplishments? What's their favorite part of Mesa? This really helped guide our work. And from there, we did a value proposition where students reflected on the past and present of Mesa at their schools. But most importantly, again, we wanted them to dream big about the future. What did they want our program to look like? So these two activities really helped to provide a foundation for students to think about how they would tell the story of Mesa and bring students in who might self-select out. So really that peer-to-peer recruitment piece. And so the question is, did it work? Well, here's what we found. Approximately 35% of our Mesa participants this past year noted they learned about Mesa from a current participant. Pretty significant. That's a pretty high number of students saying that that's why I came into this program. Now, unfortunately, I don't have longitudinal data because we weren't collecting this information before. Thanks to STEM Push for showing us that, like, that was a big oversight in what we were collecting. So now we know we need to be asking that question. Why are you coming into the program? How are you learning about it? Why are you connected to it? So we're still doing this work and we have a lot more to do. Okay. Finally, the most recent improvement group I participated in was about embedded supports for college and career. And so thinking about back to, you know, the student surveys that we did because of STEM Push, thinking about our focus groups, thinking about our leadership meetings, storytelling activities, the thing that was clear was that we need to have fun. Obvious, right? We needed to have fun. So time and again, that's what they wanted. So here's the other thing. If you work with students, which I know you do, they'll tell you they want things and then they don't show up. So they'd be like, we want college panels and career panels. And I was like, yes, we will do those. And then they wouldn't show up. And I was like, okay, guys, what gives? Because of the work in STEM push, and like the first thing I did was like, I'm going to go to the students and ask them, why are you not showing up? And they had a variety of reasons, right? They're too busy. They forgot. They figured there'd be another one they could attend in the future. So working with STEM push and some of my colleagues in there, was able to turn panels on their head and turn it into a game. We gamified it. It became a what's my. So they would know who the students were as far, we had like college students. And so they had these different majors. So we had, for example, health sciences, computer science, business administration, and graphic design, but they didn't know who was who. I cannot tell you how much the students got excited about this. They were trying to sleuth it out. I know who the computer science person is. I know who it is. And they would try to figure it out. And then we would test them at the end. It was the most engaged panel I've ever seen. It's amazing. This is all we do now. This is how we do panels. It is such a great way to get students involved and get them excited. In the meantime, it breaks down stereotypes about different majors and different fields of study because they're questioning things like, oh, are you introverted? That must mean you're a computer engineer. Not necessarily, right? Oh, you like to play games? Clearly you're the computer scientist. Not necessarily. So we really were able to break those down and get students to really think about things and ask really insightful questions. All right. So I'm going to bring it back together now. It was a lot of stuff really fast. I talk quickly, even though I'm from the West Coast. These are just a really brief snapshot, of how STEM push has impacted us. Really, again, without being part of this group, we simply did not have the bandwidth to be able to try new programming and to learn from others in the network. So the ability to try and make decisions to either adopt, adapt, or abandon, it's really been invaluable for our program. And we work to meet students where they are. And this means that we are more actively listening to our students and learning from them. And really, that has just made all the difference for our program. So can't say enough wonderful things about STEM push and our participation in it. Thank you.
Oh, thanks so much, Janine and Becky and Mackenzie. So with that, we've shared a bit about STEM push and how some of these pre-college programs engage. And so I think there's a couple of questions in the chat that we can certainly address. And then we can also, I don't know that we'll do small group breakouts. I think we'll go ahead and just do some discussion and Q&A here. But we wanted to actually, you know, maybe talk a bit with the NCWIT membership about how we might better identify racially and ethnically underrepresented students to recruit them for participation in these programs, right? Outside of students who are in advanced STEM courses, like what else? What else are you all doing to help recruit? And then how we might better leverage students' program accomplishments in the admissions process if we have any folks here from that world. So I'll stop sharing screen and maybe we can dig into some of the questions.
I see one question from the chat that we're just going to do a bit of a remix. And so we know that NC recognizes the importance of family engagement when it comes and its role in students' persistence, particularly in the STEM fields. How do these pre-college programs engage and utilize families?
So I'm going to provide a high level, and then I'm going to turn it over to my colleagues. So within our membership, I would say the answer is it's highly variable. Some programs do not engage families beyond really the permission stage, like, you know, advertising and getting permission, and maybe a showcase kind of a moment. Others that come to mind, for example, Case Western Reserve's Provost Scholars Program, led by Faye Gary, intricate, consistent engagement of families routinely. They bring those families in. The families come in for group things weekly. It's very, very insistent that families be part of their students' experience within the program. And they've had great success with that. So across our network, huge variation, tremendous variation. But I don't know if Janine, Becky, and Mackenzie want to speak to it from the actual program perspective.
Yeah, I can start. So with Gene Team, it's something that we're trying to build more. But what we have done is meet with families prior to the start of the program so that everyone, we talk about the program expectations, but also just so they can see where their kid is going to be, see the lab, set to rest any like safety concerns or anything like that. And, you know, just have that time with them before the program starts. And we also, a lot of what we do is through social media during the program with the teachers or with the families, excuse me, to kind of, give them a glimpse into what's happening daily or at least every other day to give them, a sense of what their kids are working on. And then that presentation at the end of the program that I mentioned, it's not just for the scientists in our department, but for the families as well. So it's a challenge for our students because they're presenting, most of their families are not in STEM. And so they have to give a presentation for non-STEM family members and also our scientists in our community. So it's actually a really nice way for the families to see how much they've grown over the course of the program.
Nice. Yeah, and I'll go. Not only is it National Technology Day, it's also World Ego Awareness Day. So I will check my ego at the door and just be really honest about it. Our program has done a terrible job about reaching out to families. And, it's been something that has been on our radar. We've known, we really have to do this. And when we were at the convening in March, I sat next to somebody talking about their family engagement, and we were telling stories about students, and family kept coming back. And it was like, it was basically being hit over the head with it. Like, I got to pay attention to this. I got to stop putting this aside. And so now I'm actually part of an improvement group now, which is building college app capacity, which doesn't sound like it would have a connection to families, but it absolutely does. And so our program, we now have staff and we're spending time looking at this and saying, okay, how do we get our students to understand the skills that they're learning for their college applications? And how do we get the parents along with that? How are we bringing the families into it? So we have a lot of work to do. But again, working on this improvement group, being around these people who are running pre-college STEM programs who are doing this work is making it so much easier. It would have been honestly kind of insurmountable for me to even get past that stage of we have to do this work without the support of a network. So now we're working on it. Check in with me in a year and I'm going to have some good news for you, but we're still working. Yeah.
And let me add in one more thing. Outside of a direct engaging the family members, caregivers with the program, all of our programs work on building culturally sustaining pedagogical practices, which center understanding and including the assets of the family, the cultures from and communities from which the students are coming. And so I think all programs are working to understand better the communities from which their students come, the assets and strengths of those communities, because we use this sort of rightful presence model that all students have a rightful presence in STEM. And so the cultures, the traditions, the values, all that that come from their communities belong in STEM, and we have to figure out how to connect it, elevate it, help them see those linkages. So I do think that there's family engagement in that way across all the programs, even if instrumentally there's more variation. And Mackenzie, I don't know if you want to address that as well. I know we're getting close to time.
No, I think you guys summed it up perfectly.
I'm going to just take another question from the chat right now, but if there's anyone who's with us live that would like to raise their hand, we'll call on you and can ask a question. But just, you were able to take such a deeper dive. What are some of the biggest challenges that you experienced with each of your programs? And what are some of the ways that being part of the STEM Push Network has helped you with scaling your program, making it more sustainable and more accessible?
I'm happy to start. I did cover it a little bit as I was talking in my presentation, but just to really, really underscore it. I think that because we're an out-of-school, after-school program, students will self-select out. It's not for me. It's not my thing. And we have really lamented that for years of running this program. How do we reach those students? It really is sort of the fault of one of our colleagues in STEM Push, Jen Shearer, who said to me, storytelling is really important. And I was like, Yeah, we got to do storytelling. And it set me off on a path that just I haven't looked back, of really getting students to tell their story, making sure we're telling the story. And as students go back to the schools, really being excited about it. And we're seeing students come into the space now where it's like, no, this is actually like fun. And it's a good time and you're going to enjoy this. But I honestly don't think that would have happened without STEM Push. It really made us have to reconsider how we were doing all of this work. And so we are getting students who would have self-selected out actually saying, I have a space now. This is where I need to be. I'm part of this. This is my community. And so really STEM Push has just given us then those tools to be able to do that. And it's really been amazing where we've been able to scale work that we just simply couldn't do without that support.
Yeah, and I'll just quickly echo what Janine had said earlier about capacity. And so for a little while, I was a team of one. Normally we're like a team of two. And so it's, you know, that's tough. And to keep this going in a way that's meaningful for students. And so the support of the network has been just, you know, so beneficial to, like Janine mentioned, it's makes trying things out and improving our programs easy. With the support of people who are, you know, help guiding us along the way, really, really, you know, from a program point of view, makes our programs better, makes us better as, leaders, and you know, just hopefully is helpful for the students.
I see one more question. I actually see a couple, but I think we have one more question hot off the chat presses right now. How do programs get involved in STEM Push? Is there like a Groupon or something?
Well, right now, we are an NSF research project, and so we have fully recruited all of our research programs. But we do have another sort of model of participation called a scaling model, which so if folks are part of pre-college STEM programs, please have them reach out. We'd love to have a follow-up conversation, explore ways that their programs could engage with and benefit from the vibrant network that is STEM Push. And we're moving towards scale and sustainability. And so we're looking for ways to make this network last even beyond the grant period of the National Science Foundation Alliance grant. So yeah, reach out, please. My email is just iriti, I-R-I-T-I at pitt.edu. So feel free to shoot me an email.
I just can't express enough gratitude to you all, not just for sharing your information and resources and insights tonight, but for the continued work that you're doing. Just thank you so much. To you, our participants, thank you so much as well. We hope that you'll join us for next season as we continue our series. We're also, you can view past webinars by going to the link in the chat. Finally, look out for a survey in your email within the next few days. Responding to the survey will enter you in a drawing for a $100 Amazon gift card and a resource kit. We thank you for your responses for joining us this evening or afternoon. Most importantly, I wanted to share with you that finally, today is National Eat What You Want Day. So please, as you finish your evening or afternoon, please have a Choco Taco, a Hostess Cupcake, breakfast for dinner, or whatever you please. We hope to see you in our next series. Thank you so much.